though many form one body and belong to one another as its limbs and organs, we have gifts allotted to each of us by God's grace. I extend to all of you a very warm welcome in a warm church on a relatively warm night. The Kilrea and the parish group parishes, the newly group parishes of Kilrea and the fairly upper and Tamlaght the fairly lower. And you have come from many different places, but many of you have only come down the road from Hull and Port Glenone. And so to you we say a particular welcome and a particular thank you for gracefully releasing your record to this diocese and these parishes. Gary Millar, we are overjoyed that you're here. And we want to say to Gillian, to Daniel, to Bethan, to Hannah, to Timothy, and to Winnie, Gary's mother, how pleased we are that you are at this point in your life and in Gary's ministry. Many dignitaries and guests have joined us tonight, and we are very grateful to all of you for coming. We will acknowledge your presence at the reception afterwards. But the focus of tonight is on praying that the Holy Spirit of God will equip, lead, and guide the new rector and his parishioners for all that lies ahead.
Bishop, I present our institution the Reverend Gary Millar, who has been nominated to serve as incumbent of this parish.
We stand, let's do so quietly, reverently, prayerfully, asking for God's grace for the new record. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, we thank you that through your Son you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may be instruments of your love. And give to this your servant, Gary, the needful gifts of grace. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, is the resurrection and the life, raise us who trust in him from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that we may seek those things which are above, where he reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The first reading is taken from Exodus chapter 18, starting verse 13. The next day Moses sat as judge for the people, while the people stood around him from morning till evening. When Moses' father-in-law saw all that he was doing for the people, he said, "What is this you are doing for the people? Why do you sit alone while all the people stand around you from morning until evening?" Moses said to his father-in-law, "Because the people come to me to inquire of God. When they have a dispute, they come to me, and I decide between one person and another, and I make known to them the statutes and instructions of God." Moses' father-in-law said to him, "What you are doing is not good. You will surely wear yourself out, both you and these people with you. For the task is too heavy for you. You cannot do it alone. Now listen to me. I will give you counsel, and God be with you. You should represent the people before God, and you should bring their cases before God. Teach them instructions and make notes of
as we sing the hymn, 10,000 Reasons.
Oh,
stop for the gospel. Hear the gospel of Jesus Christ according to St. John, chapter 21, verse 15.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter cried out, because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very, very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fashion your own belt and go to wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you to where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he was glorified God. After this, he said to him, Follow me. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
And I asked about his farewells from what is now his former parishes, and he said some tears were shed, some kind things were spoken, and words of farewell were difficult for him and Gillian and the family, and I'm sure for the parishioners too. In the Gospel reading tonight, we heard words of farewell. They were among the last words spoken by Jesus in the period where we are now, between Easter, the resurrection, and the ascension. This is right where we are at this moment. And these words of Jesus were spoken at that time to the disciples and to Peter in particular. And last words, final words that people say, or almost final words in this case, are significant and need to be attended to. And the three words that I want to highlight tonight are these. Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Feed my sheep. And it was such an important concept to him that he said it three times in three different ways. Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep. So it's fair to assume that there is a key central thought in Jesus' mind that was really important for Peter. And it's fair to assume also that all of us as clergy need to ask ourselves regularly, are we feeding his sheep? Are we doing as he commanded? This is the thrust of the message I want to share with you tonight from God's Word, not least for the rector, but also for the people of the parishes here. And I have two simple questions. How do sheep get fed? And what does feeding achieve for them? The first question of how do sheep get fed, I want to begin with almost an absurdly practical notion about those white woolly creatures in the field around us. How do they get fed? It's so basic that it's hardly worth mentioning, but the truth is, the shepherd or the farmer does not physically put grass in their mouth. No, the task of the shepherd is to lead the flock to where the food is and make it available to them. But the sheep themselves are required to eat. There is an onus on the sheep in the feeding process. They must identify the food, they must chew it, they must swallow it, they must digest it. It's not only the shepherd who does the feeding of the sheep. So, in farming and in parish life, there is a joint responsibility, and it is a shared enterprise between the shepherd and the sheep to be fed. The shepherd, your new shepherd here, has a key role in feeding Jesus' sheep. But so too do you in being willing to be fed. Now this is a foundational principle that we need to pay attention to, because there are pitfalls if we don't. There are two pitfalls in particular that I want to mention. The first is that church members who expect the rector to do all the feeding can become passive consumers who complain when it's not done. listened to and read, shrewdly observes this. He said, I know churches where pastors are amazing orators, gifted speakers and communicators, but their church is filled with factions and gossip and judgmentalism and materialism and bad theology. The point being that the shepherd is offering the food to the sheep, but the sheep are not digesting it. You get the point that I'm making. Preaching and teaching, word and sacrament, pastoral care are what your new rector has come to these parishes to undertake. And you, the sheep, are the beneficiaries of it. And I know that Gary will take his responsibility as a priest, as a teacher, as a pastor very seriously, because that's the way he is. But your spiritual feeding requires something of you, the parishioner, as well. You need to take the Word of God seriously as he does. You need to take the sacraments of the Lord seriously as he does. You need to be open to being spiritually nourished as he wants you to be. He will come to you with conviction, with authority, with a pastoral heart, and he will offer you the riches of the Lord. But he will also be looking to see evidence that the flock of Christ have a desire to be fed in these parishes. And I know you do. So being fed by the Word of God results in spiritual growth and inward change in us as we are nourished by the Lord. Your rector will do his part and you will do yours. The second pitfall, however, of not being fed in the way Jesus is describing is that the pastor or the teacher or the priest can become overburdened. In the Old Testament reading that was read tonight from Exodus 18, we saw Moses, a leader who became exhausted. There are many clergy who know this experience. And his wise father-in-law, Jethro, watched him get exhausted and was fearful for his daughter, Moses' wife, that she would be left a widow. And Jethro gave some words of advice to Moses. He said, Moses, you are carrying each day with you too much of a heavy weight in leading and feeding this flock. You are exhausted by the pressures of deciding and implementing and pushing and shoving and preparing. And the people have become overly dependent on you, waiting for something to be done to them. I don't know if you know the story, which I like, of the rector who lived in a village where there was a railway line that passed through it. And every day, at the same time, he would go down to the train tracks, to the station, and he would sit on a seat and wait for the train to come. And the train would come, and he watched it, and it stopped at the station. People got on and off, and then the train moved away. And he did this every day. But he never got on the train. And people were intrigued. They said, Rector, why do you do this? And his response, I enjoy watching the only thing that moves in this parish without me having to push it. Now, I know that there is a part of these parishes to not let this happen. And so I want you to protect your new rector from his instinctive desire to overdo his work and to let what happened to Moses happen. vestries, make sure you encourage your new member as he encourages you. Make sure that he is nourished spiritually and that you are not the only beneficiaries of that ministry. So those are the words of warning to parishioners and to the rector. That was a warning to the rector too. But what does spiritual feeding achieve when the sheep are fed? And here we get to the heart of the matter. The result of being spiritually fed is not just that we feel better or feel happier or that we are entertained. It's that our souls are replenished to serve the Lord and to glorify Him. Spiritual feeding leads to spiritual growth and transformation, where the Lord is allowed by us to do a deep work within us and to change us. And I believe that your new rector will want to see this happen in you. In Psalm 23, the shepherd's psalm, the psalmist reveals that the benefit of the green pastures in which he is led by the shepherd is that his soul is restored. There's a transaction going on in the soul. And that's what your new rector will want to see in these places. He is a man of vision, I know, who longs to see the transforming grace of God at work in people's lives so that it makes a difference. And he will be pointing to ways forward for you after prayer and discernment, and in conjunction with you, as you are fed and nourished as one of the sheep. This is what Jesus did with his disciples. This is what Jesus did with the crowds. He fed them so that they were transformed and made a difference in the world. And my prayer is that this is exactly what will happen. Finished with a story, which you may know. It's sometimes told of Richard Burton, the actor, Welsh fame, and I'm not sure if it really was him, but let's say it was. The great Richard Burton was given a grand reception in his childhood parish back home in Wales. And he was the focus of attention and the hero of the hour. And after the meal, he was replying to the complimentary speeches that were made about him. And he asked if there was anything that the crowd would like him to recite. The rector, who at this point was elderly and a little frail, asked if Richard Burton would recite the 23rd Psalm. Because the rector had taught Richard Burton the psalm. The actor agreed and said, "I will do it on one condition, that after I have finished, you, my pastor and teacher, will do the same recitation." The rector said, "I'm afraid I'm no actor, but if you wish, I will do it." So, impressively, Richard Burton began the psalm and recited it with all of the perfection and eloquence that you would expect of his vocal skills. The audience was spellbound, and when he finished, there was a great burst of applause from everyone present. They were impressed. As the applause faded, the old pastor rose from his wheelchair and stood up, somewhat hesitatingly, and he began to recite the 23rd Psalm. His voice, by comparison, was weak, was unimpressive, and his tone was not faultless. And when he finished, there was silence, and hardly a dry eye in the place. The actor rose and said, "Ladies kindness is just this. I know the Son. This man knows the Shepherd. In your new rector, you have someone who knows the Good Shepherd. You have someone who has the spiritual gift of being able to tend and feed the flock. And the lambs, the little ones, they will be important. I ask you to be willing to be fed, to acknowledge your spiritual hunger, and to actively seek out the spiritual food that is offered. You have done so in the past, and I ask you to continue to do so in the future. Allow God to minister to you through this shepherd for these days. Be responsive and obedient and brave and willing to be changed. Amen.
Thank you. in the Diocese of Derry, dated this 27th day of April in the year of our Lord, 2018, and of our consecration the 16th.
I invite these the church wardens to step forward.
Thank you.
parishes, you are called together to be the body of Christ, serving God's kingdom and living together through the power of the Holy Spirit. You are called to witness to the love of Christ and to serve others in the name of Christ. The Apostle Paul writes, "I beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Will you follow in this way?" Congregation, may be seated. At this point, members of the parishes will bring forward symbols of teaching, pastoral, and sacramental ministry of an incumbent. I invite them to do so.
Have no anxiety over anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God which passes all understanding will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Gary, receive this book and be among us as one who leads public prayer and encourages in us a life of personal devotion.
With the help of the Lord,
we meet together as God's people. We pray in Christ's name. God's Spirit is in us.
As often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Gary, take this bread and wine and be among us to break the bread and to bless the cup with reverence and with joy.
With the help of the Lord, I will.
We share the bread, we drink the cup. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
I was glad when he said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord."
Derry, receive these keys and let the doors of your churches be open to all people.
With the help of the Lord, I will.
Keep watch, O Lord, for our dwellings are coming in, from this time forth forevermore.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, strengthen and sustain me in this ministry to which I have been called. Give me the vision of your glory and make me worthy of my calling. Amen.
Congregation, please stand.
Are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into the one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We share with one another a sign of God's peace.
I would invite members of other churches, civic leaders, political leaders, elected representatives to come forward and greet the new rector, please.
now together in worship once more as we sing our offertory hymn. And the collection is for the diocesan ministry fund. And we pray to God together as we sing "And Can It Be?"
Thank you. Rekindle our hope, revive our strength,
refresh our hope. Strengthen and secure this church and the church universal through the name that you have placed above all other names, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God, may the Father of life pour his grace upon you. May you feel his hand in everything you do. May you be strengthened by the things that he brings you through. This is our prayer for you. May the Son of God be Lord in all your ways. May he shepherd you all the length of your days. And in your heart, may he receive all praise. God, this is our prayer for you. May his Spirit comfort you and make you strong. May he discipline you gently when you go wrong. And in your heart, may he give you a son. This is our prayer for you. And God, may Jesus be Lord in all your ways. May he shepherd you through all the length of your days. And in your heart, may he receive all the praise. This is our prayer for you, our and our beloved brother in Christ. Amen.
And we offer our prayers to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us when we pray for the coming of his kingdom and for his will to be done. So as brothers and sisters gathered here together, we pray as one to God our Father. Our Father.
And to hear the calling, not only upon my life, but upon
upon all of our lives as we would seek to love and to serve the Lord. So we sing together, O Church, arise and put your armor on.
Join us for the refreshments. Just across the Presbyterian.